Okay, good morning again. Yesterday we finished a lot of commands. So I hope all of you did at least a little bit of practice on Vim, or maybe even looked at a few of the commands which are written in the email, the core utils. Okay. So if you haven't, maybe you should, because they form the, like I said yesterday, they form the base of the Unix toolkit. So make sure you get used to Vim. And today, I'll be starting on shell scripting. Okay. These are like programs which you write on shell. Since we don't have so much time in one session, I won't be showing you all the examples on the terminal. I'll be just showing you the first one, how to make a simple script on the terminal. You can see that example, and the rest of them I'll just show you the actual script on the screen, so you can see the code. So I told you earlier that the bash shell is a complete programming environment. So what we're going to do is we're going to actually program in this environment. So when you mean program, right now you've just been using commands that do something specific. They operate on some file. They produce some output. What we're going to do is we're going to combine these commands with certain programming constructs. So the most familiar, the most used programming constructs are if. So you want a conditional. Conditionals, you want to execute some command based on some condition. And then you have loops. So you want to execute some commands repeatedly until some, as long as some condition is true or until some condition becomes false. So we're going to combine commands and control structures to produce programs that scripts that do something useful. So let's see how do we create a script? How do you create a shell script file? Now to create a script file, a shell script file is just a plain text file. Okay, it's a file which you create in Vim or VI, okay, just like any other text file. So you create a file with Vim, and generally we save this file with an extension .sh. Okay, that's a convention. We save it with sh so that it's easier for us to identify that it's a bash shell script. Now, in order to make a shell script, to complete the process of making a shell script, you need to make a shell script executable. Okay, so you remember the chmod command? We did chmod u plus x tells that to make this particular file executable for the user, so for yourself. So this makes this particular script file, mystrip.sh, becomes executable when you execute this command. The other thing you need to do to make a script file is you need the first line of a bash script file to be this. Okay? I hope you can see it in the map. I'll write it. So the first line of your script file should be this. Okay. It's a hash, okay, exclamation mark, slash bin, slash dash. No spaces, okay, it's just one line. This should be the first line of your script file. So whatever you're editing, this should be the first line. So what this line does is it tells the operating system that this particular file should be interpreted. Okay, this file contains, what does this file contain? It contains syntax which is understood by the bash shell. So this line tells the operating system that this particular file should be interpreted by the bash command, by the bash shell. So that's what we're telling the operating system. So you need to do this and you need to make the file executable. Now your shell, your script is ready to run. Now the simplest possible script that you can make. Okay. We're not using any programming constructs. How do you make a simple script? So you type a lot of commands on the command line. You use a lot of commands, cd, ls, grep, find. Okay. You can just put these commands in sequence into a script file. And what it's going to do is it's going to run these commands in sequence, one after the other. So the same commands which you run at the prompt, we're going to just put them in a script file. So consider this script file. Maybe I'll just show you a quick example of how to make a script file. Now we use the Vim editor. I've already typed this script in earlier. Okay, so this is what a script file looks like. So you can see the first line. So the first line is our first line. The first line is a hash bang slash bin bash, where this tells the object that that's a shell script. And these are just lines that you type in. So you might not have, I didn't mention this command in yesterday's or the previous classes, echo. The echo command does something very simple. This is a string, okay, just some text which you type after the echo command. What it does is it prints that out to standard output. Okay, so echo takes whatever you've written there and writes it to standard output. So we know what standard output is connected to by default. Okay, it's a screen, the console. So what does that command do? It prints the line listing of current directory. It just prints those words on the screen. The next command is ls. The next command is ls. You know what ls does? It lists the contents of the current directory. Again, we're typing an echo. Okay, listing of the root directory. Now we change our directory to slash, to the root directory, cd slash. We're changing our directory. And again, we're running the ls. Okay, so we just put this in a file and save it using colon w. Okay, we'll exit. Now we make it executable, chmod u plus x and a script file. Now it's executable. Now it's ready to run. So if you want to run the script, you just do dot slash and the name of the script. And that's output. Okay. So this is the output of the current directory, and this is the output of the slash directory. So this is the same script. Now there's something important I need to mention. So you've seen how when I'm running this command, what it does is we have a bunch of commands which we put in a script file. Now instead of typing those commands one after the other at the shell prompt, we just put in a file so that whenever we run the script file, it just runs those commands one after the other. So it's like a convenience. We run the commands together. We don't have to do each step again. So is this the same? So this is exactly the same as typing this sequence of commands at the prompt. So suppose you typed echo ls and these commands on the prompt. Okay, it's the same as running the script file, but except for one small difference. Okay, so I'm running the script now. Okay, we got our output. Now we just check our present working directory, our current working directory. Okay. We're in this directory, shell scripting examples. Okay. Now I'll do one thing. I just run those commands sequentially at the prompt. Okay. So I'll type echo listing. Okay. That printed the line on standard output. Now I'm typing ls. Okay. I got the output. Now I'm doing echo listing root. Now I'll do cd slash, and now I'll do ls again. I just executed the exact same sequence of commands on the prompt. But let's check the present working directory now. Okay, we're in a different working directory. So this is the difference of running in a script and running at the prompt. Okay, this is important. So what happens? Why does this happen? This is because when you put commands in a script, and then you run the script, those commands within the script are not running your present shell session. What happens is your shell starts another copy of a shell. It's called a subshell. Okay, so a subshell is started in your computer. It's a separate process. Okay, so a new process is created. And it is this new shell, this new subprocess that actually executes your commands. Okay, so whatever happens inside a new shell, when you do a CD or a LS or any, suppose you create an environment variable, okay, these affect only that shell, the subshell. They don't affect any state within the shell that the parent shell. Okay, so the cd command is one of the commands that actually modifies the environment. Okay, so your current working directory is actually stored in an environment variable. Now, since that earlier script was running inside a subshell, it did not affect our current shell. But when we ran the exact same sequence of commands in our present shell, it affected our current working. So this is a subtle difference that you need to know about when you're, because sometimes you might expect a script to actually modify the environment of your running shell, but this is not what happens. A script always runs in a subshell. back to slides. Okay, so now we'll go to pipes. Yesterday, in the last two classes, we spoke about the standard output and standard input. So the standard output and standard error are by default connected to your console. Okay, so whenever the program writes something to standard output, it comes to your console, the screen. Okay, the screen is what we call the console. And the standard input is by default connected to your keyboard. So whatever you type at the keyboard is read from standard input by your program. Now, in Unix, you can connect two commands together by using a pipe symbol, okay? That's just the bar, pipe. What it does is, so suppose you type a command like this. Suppose you use a command that's in your script, command one, pipe, command two. What it does is it connects the standard output of command one to the standard input of command two, okay? But command two, the standard output of command two is the usual standard output, your console. The standard input of command one stays the same, your keyboard. But then it's redirected, okay? So the output of this command goes to this. So you're not, suppose this command was ls. So it, by default, ls writes to the standard output. But then if you pipe it to another command, the output is not going to come to the screen. It's going to go to the standard input of the next command. So this is a very powerful mechanism for combining the programs in our Unix toolkit together. So let's look at an example. There's a sort command. What the sort command does is it, if you pass some text, you can run sort with a file name, so sort some file name. What it does is it writes the sorted out text to the standard output. So suppose you have a file which contains some lines. It sorts those lines in the alphabetical order and then writes it out to standard output. That's what sort does. Now there's another command called unique, UNIQ, unique. What unique does is, unique also reads a file. When unique sees two lines which are the same, okay, when it sees two consecutive lines that are the same, it removes the duplicates, okay? So it prints only one copy of duplicate lines. So suppose you have three or more, or any number of lines, consecutive lines which are the same, it's gonna remove all the duplicates and just print out one line to the standard output. Now, for the rest of this, I just created a sample input file that we'll use for sort and unique. It's called the fruits.txt. It contains some well-known fruits. These are the ones. So you can see that it contains some duplicates. Okay, we have an apple here, two strawberries, two mangoes. So what we need to do is we want to write a script that removes duplicates. Now we can't pass this input file directly to Unique because Unique is not going to remove the duplicates, because the only duplicate that Unique will remove is strawberry, because it's going to see two consecutive duplicate lines and then it's going to remove one of them, right? But it's not going to remove the mango and the apple. So what we need to do is we need to sort this file first. Then we take the sorter output, pass it into Unique. Okay, in that case, Unique can do its job. So how do we do this? So we need to sort before Unique. We'll create a little script file called uniquefruits.sh, and this script file will do our job for us. We'll remove duplicate entries from our file. So you'll be seeing a lot of this script, uniquefruits. We'll be using it in showing you more constructs later on. Very short script. This is the actual text of the script. You have your standard hashbang line, okay, to tell the OS that it's a script. And this is a simple line. So sort fruits, what does sort fruits do? Sort fruits reads the fruits input file, sorts the lines, and writes output to standard output. Now your pipe symbol is there, so your standard output doesn't come to screen. It's piped to the unique command. Now the unique command also takes a file name like this. But if you call the unique command without a file name, by default, it reads its input from standard input. Okay? So if you specify a file name here, it's going to read that file name to get its. It's going to read the data in that file, and then it's going to remove duplicates from that file. But since we're not specifying a file name here, by default, the Unix commands are going to read their input from standard input. Very simple script. What it does is it's going to sort the file, remove duplicates, and print it out to the screen, to standard output. Now, we'll talk about redirection. Now, suppose this our little code prints out the file with the duplicates removed. It prints out the lines on the screen. Now, suppose we wanted to capture this output to a file. Suppose we wanted to save it somewhere, this output which comes from this command. So what you do is you use the shell redirect operator. Okay? It's just a greater than sign. So if you write a command like this, if you write command greater than file, what it does is, again, it connects the standard output of your command and redirects that output to a file. Okay? So technically, standard output itself is a file. So it's going to redirect that output. So whatever the command is writing to standard output goes into this file. So it doesn't come on the screen. Okay, it just goes to the file. And then you can read that file later using cat or less. You can open it again. Now we're going to modify our unique fruits.sh script so that it writes the output to the file. Okay. So just a simple change. We just add the greater than and the unique fruits.txt. So now when you run this script, the output, your duplicate removed output goes into this file, unique fruits.txt. Okay. Very simple change. So pipes are not limited to two commands. Maybe that is not obvious earlier. So you can connect any number of programs and using multiple number of pipes. Okay, so this is called a pipeline. Okay, so what a pipeline is, it's like plumbing. Okay, you have something flowing and passing through several filters. So these are actually all these programs behave as though they were filters. Some data is coming in, it performs some manipulation on the data, it goes to the next one. This one does some kind of manipulation on the data, goes out. What does the NL command do? The NL command does the same thing which you saw yesterday. When you type less hyphen N, what did you get? You got the same, you could view the lines of your file, but a line number was prepended to it. So the NL does the same thing. The NL command does the same thing. It prepends a line number to each line of the file. Okay? And then the output is written, like earlier, to your unicfruits.txt. So you can combine any number of commands like this.
Each job should be waiting for the previous job to finish, right?
Not exactly. So they are only connected to each other by a pipe. So as soon as the first job is writing data to its std out, the other one is reading it from std in. Okay, so the only connection between them is like a supplier and someone is sending data to a file, and this one is reading from a file. So they could be running simultaneously. But suppose this program does not produce output. The sort command is one of those programs that does not produce output until it completes reading its input, right? You need to read all the input before you can sort. So sort doesn't produce output in real time. So sort has to complete. Then only it sends its data to std out. Then it goes to unique, okay? And then unique does its job. So there are some commands which, like bzip, gzip. Okay? Gzip can read a file and it can compress it continuously without the input ever stopping. Now, you'll notice that we mentioned the name of the file that this script has to sort. The name of the file is inside the script itself. So this script is really, it's inflexible. Okay, it's not good design. It's generally bad programming practice to hard code. Hard code means putting the name of a file or some value permanently in a file. So permanently in a program. So here we've hard coded the name fruits.txt in our script file. Now this is bad programming practice because it makes a script inflexible. Okay, whenever you need to remove duplicates, you need to save your file as fruits.txt. Then only the script will work. So we want to make it a little more flexible, improve the program. Now you saw the sort command takes argument fruits.txt. This is a command line argument. Sort takes fruits.txt as a command line argument and operates on that. So we want to modify our script so that our script accepts a command line argument. So that we want something that will work like this. Okay, we want to type unique fruits.sh and specify the file name on which it should remove duplicates. So how do we do this? Now inside a script file there are some special variables. Okay, there are some special variables that $1, $2, $3 and so on. These are variables which you can use inside your script. Now $1, $2, what is the value of them? $1 contains the value of $1, it will be containing the first command line argument. $2 will be having the second command line argument, $3. So if you have n number of command line arguments, you're going to have up to $n. Now $0 is a special variable. It means the name of the script itself. Okay, it'll become clear in the next slide. So suppose you executed a command like this in your script, on your command line, on the prompt. If you typed /unique fruits, our script, and you specified fruits.sh and vegetables.sh, okay, some names, command line arguments. Inside your script, if you access the variable $1, okay, it's going to contain this value, fruits.txt. Okay, if you access $2, it's going to have vegetables.txt, and $0 contains the actual name of the script itself. So if you change the name of your script, okay, if you change the name of the file, that new file name is going to come here. Okay. So this is our modified script, the new script. We've removed that fruits.txt hard coding value, and we just put the $1 over there. So what this means is if you run, we're going to run it like this, sorry. If you run unique fruits with just with a file name, that file name is going to come over here. Now, I'll be talking about this quotes later on, but just remember that whenever you're using a variable, just keep them in between the double quotes. Yeah? I'll explain why later on. So what does the shell do over here? So the shell, when you write a script file, the shell is looking at each line in your script, and it's executing each line at a time. So when the shell notices something like this, okay, a dollar sign and a name, it knows that it's a variable, which can, may or may not contain a value. What it does is it expands that. We call it expand, a shell expansion. What it means is that it takes this variable out, okay, and replaces its value over there. So if you call the program /unique fruits.sh fruits.txt, this $1 is replaced by the shell internally with fruits.txt. So this line effectively is interpreted by the shell as sort fruits.txt pipe unique. So that's how variables work. Wherever you put the variables, they're replaced with their value. Now suppose $1 didn't have a value, you'll just have a blank over here. Null, okay? Now, before we go into conditional execution of commands, suppose you want to execute a command based on some condition, we'll talk about exit status. Every command in Unix and Linux returns an exit status. So when you run a command, it returns an exit status. Exit status is nothing but it's an integer. So when your command completes, it returns an integer to the shell. This integer tells you whether that command succeeded or not. So if the integer is zero, that means that the command executed successfully. If it's non-zero, that means something happened. Either the command failed or it encountered some error. So we look at the grep command, since we'll be using it in our next script, the grep command. So yesterday, I made a brief mention of the grep command. What does grep do? So in the man page, the definition, the name part of the man page says that grep prints lines that matches the pattern. Okay? We looked at this yesterday. This is the synopsis. This is how you run a grep command. So grep, some options, a pattern, and files. These are the files it's going to search for this pattern for. So you can see that file is an optional thing in square brackets. So you don't have to specify a file. If you don't specify a file, that means it's going to read from standard input. But the pattern is compulsory. You have to specify a pattern. Now yesterday I told you that patterns can have some special meta characters and you can search for some generalized strings. But right now for our current example, we just consider pattern to be a word, a literal word. Now, we're going back to our fruits example. You remember this file? Let's run this command on a prompt. We'll run grep. The pattern is apple. The file which we're going to run grep on is fruits.txt. Now this is the output that's produced. Okay, you get apple, both apples, and you get a pineapple also. So why do you get that? Because so grep is going to find a match even when the word is part of another word. So suppose you have apple embedded in a bigger word. It's going to print that result out too. So it doesn't care about whether it's a separate word or not. Okay. So that's what we say. Over here, you say apple is a substring. Apple is a substring of the larger string pineapple. Pineapple is a string. Apple is a substring in that. So grep, by default, also prints out, it considers a substring a match. How do you suppress that behavior? You can run grep with the hyphen W option. The hyphen W option tells grep that only search for complete words. So if you run grep, the exact same line with the W option, you just get the lines which you want. It does what you expect. Now, grep, just like every other command, also returns an exit status. The exit status of grep is 0 if it finds a match. If it finds one or more matches. Suppose you are passing a file to grep and you're searching for apple. Suppose it found one or more lines which match the word apple. It's going to print out the lines. Plus, when grep exits, it's going to return an exit status of 0. That means it succeeds. Now, suppose grep did not find any line which is matching the pattern, it's going to return exit status of 1, non-zero. It can return any other. Suppose it encoded an error, like it could not find the file. Suppose it could not find the file fruit structure, it's going to return another exit status. But the fact is that if it's non-zero, it failed. If it's 0, that means we found a match.
Yes, sir. Where does it write that status?
Yeah, so the exit status, right now in the script I'll show you how to collect the exit status. At the prompt, I'll tell you at the end of the class. How to see the exit status of a command at the prompt.
So by default, where does it write?
It's held in the shell in a variable. So I'll tell you that variable at the end of the class because it might confuse things. But right now I'll show you how to collect it inside a script. How to know the exit value inside a script. So we know that the grep command returns an exit status. So we can know whether grep found a match or not by looking at the exit status. Now, we want to create a small script here. We want to make a little example script that does something. What the script does is it's going to look at a file and determine whether that file is a shell script or not. So how do you know if a file is a shell script? Suppose you were browsing through some files. How would you know it's a shell script? Maybe you would get a hint by seeing that it has a .sh extension. But how would you know for sure? You would open the file and you would look for the first line. Right? You'd see that. So if you see this, that means it's a shell script. Right? So we'll write a script that looks for this line. And this script is very simple, very naive script. Okay? It's easy to fool, but it does a job. If it finds this line inside a file, it's going to say that this is a script file. So we're going to write a script that can detect whether a file is a script or not. So how do you do this? We're going to use the grep command and the if construct to do this. So now we know that grep returns the exit status. Now let's see the if construct. So if is a built-in construct of the shell. So if you want to see the syntax or how to use a built-in construct, you just type help and that construct. So you just type help and if, and you'll get some information of what's the syntax for that construct. So I'll just show you the script using the if. Now, the if construct, I was supposed to put a slide where I just show you the if construct, but now I'll just explain to you. So how do you create an if construct inside your script? You put the keyword if, and whatever comes after if is the condition. Whatever comes after if is the condition. So if this condition is true, whatever comes after then, okay, then is also a keyword. Then is a keyword. So you put if condition then in some commands and fi. Fi marks the end of the block. Maybe it's not visible. I'll write on the board. So this is what an if looks like. So how do you make an if? You put if some condition. Yeah, I'm writing this in all caps because you're not supposed to write the word condition there, right? It's supposed to be a command or something, an expression, just like the man page. So if condition, then, this is a literal word, you have to type the word then, and then you put some commands over here. So if this condition is true, it's going to run these commands, and you close the if block with fi. Okay, fi is like if written backwards. So if this condition is true, these commands are going to be run. Now, before the FI, if you put an else, if you put something like this, and some commands, and you close the block, what this means is that if the condition is true, it's going to execute those commands. Otherwise, suppose the condition is not true, it's going to execute this commands. Now, if you wanted to check more conditions, one after the other, you can use something called an elif. Okay, so you can use elif and some more conditions. So if you put an elif, you can put any number of elif statements here. So what does elif do? If this condition is true, it's going to execute this. Okay. If this condition is not true, it's going to check this condition. And if this condition is true, it's going to execute these commands. You have to put the then again, right? Okay, elif then. And then finally, you'll have an else statement.
And there will be two FIs.
Sorry?
To complete the next if.
No, just one. So this FI closes this. Okay, it tells the shell that the if block ends here.
And the elif block?
The elif block, so if you put an else block, that's going to mark the end of the elif. If you don't have an elif block, if you don't have an else block, the FI marks the end of that. So just ignore this, maybe it's confusing. Okay. So just your simple. Okay. So after the, if the condition is true, it's going to execute all the commands, okay, continuously. So how do you tell it when to stop? You put a FI. That tells you that, okay, you execute only the commands between the then and the FI if the condition is true. That's the if block. So same thing here. We have this condition here, grep. Here our condition is a command. And we have a then. So if the condition is true, it's going to execute this line. You know the echo command. And if the condition is not true, it's going to print this line. So what's our condition? Our condition is our command grep. So grep searches for this pattern, slash bin slash bash. Okay, I forgot to put the hash bang here, but you can do that. So what it searches, what does grep do here? Grep searches for this line, slash bin slash bash, without the quotes. Okay, without the quotes. So it searches for the actual, this string, slash bin slash bash, inside this file. So $1 contains what? $1 contains your first command and argument, which you saw earlier. Okay. So this is $1, fruit stud, whatever we give over there. So what grep is going to do is going to search for this string within this file. And if it finds that the string is present within the file, it's going to evaluate to true. Okay. It's going to evaluate to true. And this if condition will become true. Now, when the if is true, it's going to print the line file is a shell script. Okay? And if it's not true, it's going to print file is not a shell script. So very simple script. Now, when you run the script, let's see what happens. Suppose you run the script and pass it the name of an actual script file. This is the output which you get. You get the output file is a shell script. Okay, it works. The command works. But you get one extra line over here. You get the actual line which it matched. You got the language matched. So why is this happening? So you remember the man page of grep, it says it prints the lines which are matching the pattern. So not only did grep find the pattern, it printed it out, and it also returned the exit status of success. So we need to suppress this. We don't want our program to print the line that's matching. We just want it to tell us whether it's a script or not. So let's fix this. Now there's a special file. In the first class I told you that the Unix shows everything as a file. So there are some files which really don't exist on disk, but they're there in visible. If you type ls, you can actually see the file, but they don't exist on disk. One of these files is slash dev slash null. Okay, the file name is null, it's within the dev directory. What is a null file? What is a dev null? Dev null is a special file where if you write data to this file, it doesn't go anywhere, it just disappears. This file accepts data, but does not store it anywhere. So as long if you write an unlimited number of data into dev null, it just disappears. Okay? So nothing happens. This kind of file it doesn't exist on the disk, which does something special. It's called a device special file. There's a whole bunch of device special files which are used for special purposes, and all of them are in the dev directory. So we'll change the script. It's the same script as before, exactly same script. We just added this. We're redirecting the output of the grep command to dir null. So now your the output. So grep is going to print the matching line. The matching line is going to be written to dir null. Now it's not going to come to your screen because it's going to go into dir null. The rest of the script is the same. If you run this now, you'll get the expector output. You'll just see the line that the file is in the script file. Now, so in the previous example, we used the actual command as the condition. So how does it work? It returns an exit status. So if is actually checking the exit status of grep. If the exit status is 0, it executes as 9. If it's non-zero, it executes as 9. Now we can use other conditions too. There are other conditions which you can check for an if statement. And there are two keywords in the shell, built-in commands in the shell, which you can use for this. It's called test, and this construct here, this is a bracket, square brackets. These two are exactly the same. Okay? They mean the same thing. It's just two different ways to write the same command. So what does this test do? What does this bracket do? So if you type test in some condition, some expression, it's going to return 0 if the condition is true. It's going to return non-zero, 1 if it's false. And the same thing for the brackets. So inside the brackets, if you put a condition, the bracket is going to return 0 if the condition is true. Non-zero. So if you're getting a 0 and a 1, we can use that as a condition for the if. So if just operates on the return exit status. So let's see an example. Now, in our early examples, $1 contains the name of the file, the first command line argument. So, suppose you typed a command like this. Suppose you typed if bracket. Okay. We're not using test here, but we'll call it test. We'll call this bracket test. So, if test hyphen e and our variable, $1. So, what does the shell do when it sees this? It sees the $1, and I told you earlier, when the shell sees a $1, what is it going to do? It's going to substitute it. It's going to expand it to the name of the first command line argument. So suppose $1 was containing fruits.txt. So you're going to get if bracket hyphen e fruits.txt. So what does it do? If inside the brackets, inside this test command, if you put a hyphen e, what it does is it checks if the file exists. So this condition returns a 0. It returns true if this file exists. If the file does not exist, it returns false. Now, one important thing you need to know is the syntax. You have to keep spaces between the brackets and this condition, and the condition and the string. So, like I told you earlier, it's unlike C. Bash does not tolerate spaces or the lack of spaces. So, it'll interpret this command differently. If you wrote a bracket just next to the hyphen, it's not gonna work. So, the bracket is actually a keyword. The bracket is a keyword, it's a command. Therefore, you have to keep it separate. You have to keep the space between the if and the condition. And also the same for the last one. So this is a condition for checking if a file exists. Now suppose you wanted to negate that. Suppose you wanted to check if a file does not exist. You could just put an exclamation mark before this. And this is like the not, Boolean not operator. What it does is, if this evaluates to true, the not makes it into false. If this evaluates into false, the not makes it into true. Again, you have a space in between on both sides. So if you don't put a space, it'll stop working. So this is how you negate. So this checks if the file, okay, so this is, $1 can be a file or a directory. So this returns true even if it's a directory. Now there's another condition which you can check if it's a directory. If you, instead of hyphen e, if you put hyphen d, it's gonna return true if $1 is pointing to a directory. If it's a file, it's gonna return false. If you want to check if it's a regular file, not a directory, it'll be hyphen f. So there's a whole bunch of these tests you can do. You just have to type help test on the prompt. Help test on the prompt, you'll see all these listed there. Now, you can also do string comparison within this test. So I think you can't see it. You can do something like this. Okay, there's a typo there, it's not capital if, it's a small if. So it's case sensitive, these keywords. It has to be small if. So if you type if, space. Is there anything? So what is this condition? So suppose you did not pass any command line argument to your script. $i is not going to contain anything. It's going to expand to nothing. So when the shell expands $i to nothing, you'll just get an empty string. So this is an empty string. It's just two quotes, nothing in between, no spaces also. So we're checking if $i is empty. So this whole condition is going to return true, it's going to return zero, if this $i does not contain anything, if it's an empty string. Yeah, otherwise it's going to return false. Now there are other operators you can use. There are other operators you can use here. You can use greater than, okay? You can use less than, okay? There are some more operators like this. This is also greater than, okay? Hyphen GT. Just like hyphen E, is hyphen GT. It checks that if this is greater than this. And hyphen LT, less than. And what's the difference between hyphen GT and this? What difference does it make? Now this one checks if the first string is lexicographically greater than the next string, and this one checks if it's arithmetically. Okay, so does that make sense? So I'll show you an example. Look at these two scripts. Okay. What does the script do? The script sets a variable, ivar equals to 6. This is how you create a variable in a shell script. You just type the name, just the same way you create an environment variable, except that you don't type export. So environment variables are shell variables, but they export it. So we're not exporting it, we're just typing ivar equals to 6. Now over here, remember that you should not have spaces. Okay? This is kind of the quirks of bash. You should not have a space here when you're creating a variable, you're assigning. So no space here. Now our if condition. We're checking if ivar, so here we have a dollar and the variable name. So when I told you earlier that when the shell sees a dollar sign and the variable name, what it's going to do? It's going to expand it to the value. So this portion is going to be replaced with 6. So actually this effectively, you're going to have in between brackets 6 greater than 16. And if this condition is true, it's going to print this string. It's going to print that 6 is greater than 16. Now this is the exact same program, but we're using greater than, hyphen GT. So which one do you think is going to print this string? This one. Yeah. So this one is going to print it. Why? Right. So it's great. So what does lexicographically mean? Lexicography is just a fancy word to say that in dictionary order. Okay? So when you say something is greater than something else, lexicography, that means it comes after it in a dictionary. So suppose you had 6 and 16 in a dictionary, which would come first? 16 would come first, right? And 6 would come later. So 6 greater than 16, that's why it evaluates to true. And that's why this is going to print for this particular. But if you use GT, it's going to check it arithmetically. Okay? And this is going to do what you expect. So you need to be careful. So because the shell doesn't care what you're putting into a variable. It's not like Fortran or C. The shell doesn't know about types. So when you assign a value to a variable, it doesn't know whether it's an integer or a string. In fact, the shell thinks everything is a string. The shell stores everything as a string. So the shell doesn't care if 6 is actually the string 6 or whether it's a value, the number 6. Now when you're doing a comparison, that time you need to use the right comparison operator to get what you expect. So if you want to know if 6 is greater than 16, you need to use this one arithmetically. So this is a difference. So for greater than, you have the equal, you have less than, you have LE, which is less than or equal to, you have GE, greater than or equal to, and you have hyphen NE, not equal to. So all the corresponding comparison operators are there, you know, with the arithmetic version also. Okay, now you can also combine, suppose you want to check more than one condition. Suppose you want to check if a number, some number is greater than this and less than this. How do you combine conditions? This is how you do it. So this, if you look at this part, this is familiar. We're checking if dollar, the value contained in this A variable is arithmetically equal to 40. And this is a separate one. We're going to check if the B variable is arithmetically equal to 51. Now, how do you combine these two? You just put a double ampersand. Double ampersand. There's a space here and here. So what does double ampersand do? This whole condition is true if this condition and this condition is true. So both of these conditions need to be true. Only then will this if, only then will the then block of this if be executed. So this is how you combine. Now you can do this, you can add more ampersands. You can put AND and something else. Or you can put AND and check some file or command. You can add any number. So there's another one, there's an OR. It's the same construct. Instead of the double ampersand, you put a double pipe symbol. So double pipe stands for OR, logical OR. So if this condition or this condition is true, the whole if block is executed. There are some other like exclusive OR and all that. You can check that in help test. Now we'll go to looping. What does a loop do? Loop executes some command repeatedly until some condition is reached, or until as long as some condition is true. So the while loop looks like this. This is how you type the while loop in your script. You type the while keyword, some condition, and the keyword do, some commands, and done. So this done marks the end of your while block. So what does this mean? As long as this condition is true, it's going to repeatedly execute these commands, which are in between the do and the done. It's going to do that repeatedly. Now we'll use this as an example. Okay, we'll get back to our unique fruits program. We want to improve it a little bit. Now our unique fruits program, you remember, it used the $1 to know which file it's supposed to remove duplicates from. Right? When we pass the file as the first command and argument, that argument comes to $1. That's a file reserve. Now suppose you want to give more than one file and the command line, it's not going to work because you're only taking $1. So suppose you want this to work. Suppose you want unique fruits file 1, file 2, file 3, and you want it to remove duplicates from each of these files and print the output in sequence. Right? Suppose you want this to work. How will we change our script? Now we're going to use a loop for this. What we're going to do is we're going to loop over each command line argument. So the command line arguments are $1, $2, $3. These are the command line arguments. And we need to loop over this. So let's assume we don't know beforehand how many command line arguments the user is going to give. So we don't know whether there's going to be $1 to $2 or there's going to be up to $5. Let's assume that. Let's design a program so that we don't know beforehand. Now whenever you create a loop, you need to decide when the loop is going to terminate. So you need a terminating condition. So that's what you have here. This is the condition. So when this condition goes false, that's when the loop terminates. So whenever you create a loop, you need to decide when the loop is going to terminate. Otherwise, it's going to loop forever. So what's a condition? So before that, I'll tell you about a small shell built-in command called shift. Shift. Okay. Shift is a shell built-in command. What does shift do? You just type the shift command. If you put the shift in your script, what it does is it moves all the values of your command line arguments left. What does that mean? $1 gets the value of $2. $2 gets the value of $3. So suppose you have some .script.sh file1.txt, file2.txt, and file3.txt. Now, when you run the script, file1.txt is in $1, right? File2.txt is in $2 in this variable, and this is in $3. Now, suppose in your script, you ran the shift command. Now what happens? $1. So this is $1. $1 is going to get whatever was in $2. Okay. So $1 is going to become this. And this is going to become $2. Okay. Is that clear? No? Okay, maybe I'll just write the values down. So suppose this is $1 variable, $2, $3. When you run your script, this is containing the value file 1. this container value file 2
.txt
.txt, and this coming file 3 .txt. Now you execute the shift command. Shift. What happens is all these moves left. So now $1 is containing file 2. And $2 is containing file 3. Now since we don't have anything after $3, this is going to be blank. Okay? $3 is going to be the empty string. Now if you execute shift again, it's going to do the same thing. Now $1 has become file 3. And $2 and $3 are going to be the empty string. Now if you do the last shift, one more shift, $1 is going to become the empty string. So now we found our termination condition. We found a condition when our loop should terminate. When should our loop terminate? Our loop should terminate when $1 becomes empty string. That means we're done with all the files. So let's write a script using that. So this is a listing. So this is our condition, while condition. So this is the same test which I showed you earlier. This is a new test. Earlier we used hyphen, we were using hyphen n. What does hyphen n mean? Hyphen n means it tells you whether this string, okay, whether this is non-zero, whether it's non-empty. So this evaluates to true. So $1, so when the shell sees this, it's going to replace $1 with the file name, right? So the hyphen n is not going to do anything on the file. It's just going to check that whether the word after after the hyphen n, if there is a word or not. So suppose $1 expanded to nothing. Suppose it was just the empty string. In that case, this would evaluate to false. That means it's false. But if $1 expanded to some file name or any word, then this condition would evaluate to true. So n checks for non-zero, whether the expression following n is non-zero. So we got a condition. So as long as the $1 is non-zero, this loop is going to keep, okay, it's going to keep looping. So what do you put inside the loop? Inside the loop, it's the same thing as our earlier unique foods. We sort the file, pass it through unique, and the output is going to come on the screen. Now before we complete the loop, before we go to the next loop, we'll explain the shift command. So that now $1, what does $1 contain now in the next loop? It contains the next command line argument. Okay, what I did there. So one shift. Now $2 is containing, so initially $1 contained file 1, now it contains file 2. So now we're ready for the next loop. So the next loop, while is going to check, is $1 non-empty? In this case, it is non-empty. So again, you go through the loop, and sort is going to remove duplicates from file 2. Again, shift happens, now file 3 is in $1, it's going to check if it's non-zero, it's not non-zero, I mean it is non-zero. It's going to print the output to stdout and shift. Now the last shift. After the last shift, $1 becomes empty. $1 is just a blank, empty string. This condition evaluates to false, your loop terminates. You're done. Your program returns. So this one will work for any number of arguments. You can pass any number of arguments after them.
Ishan, will that work with E?
Sorry?
Instead of N, if you write E, exist.
With E? No. So I told you it doesn't operate on any file. N operates on the string, the actual word. If you are listening earlier, hyphen E interprets the word that comes later as a file name. Hyphen N doesn't do any such thing. It just checks if there's a non-empty character after N. That's all. So no file here. You don't even have to pass a file name. You can just pass anything.
So if it's empty,
This will evaluate to false.
Right?
Oh, if you want to check if it's empty, you put a Z. Z stands for 0. N stands for non-zero. Okay, so if you put Z, it's going to do the opposite. But you can just put an exclamation mark and do the same thing. The next looping construct is for. The for looping construct. What does for do? So for is the same as while. This is the for construct, the for loop construct. So you have for name in list. So name is a variable name, okay, any variable name. And list is some space separated list of words. Okay, so it's just words, some words. And you have the do done just like the while. And as long as, and for every word in list, it's going to loop over this. Now, may not be clear what that means. I'll show you in the next link. So suppose we wanted to rewrite our previous example, our unique fruits, with a while loop. Suppose let's rewrite it with a for loop. Okay, same program using a for loop instead of a while loop. Before we look at the while loop, we need to look at this special variable called dollar at. Okay, this special variable dollar at. Okay. So what is dollar at? So you know that dollar one contains first command argument, dollar two second, dollar three, dollar zero the first the name of the command. So what is dollar? Dollar at expands to whenever the shell sees dollar at, it's going to expand it to all the command line arguments, okay, except dollar zero. So it's going to expand it to all the command arguments, dollar one, dollar two, dollar three, everything in one, okay, one string. So let's see an example. So like I said, in the dollar at expands to all the command line arguments. So suppose you typed a command like this at the prompt, okay, dot slash unique fruits, fruits.txt, veg.txt, three command line arguments. What will dollar at contain? Suppose you put dollar at inside your script, it will expand to this. Okay, it will expand to all three words. All three words. Now, let's rewrite our fruits script with that. So this is what it looks like. You have for, and remember the for constant is a name. This is our variable name. In is a keyword, dollar at. Again, we put quotes. Now, what is this? What is when the shell sees dollar at, what is it going to do? It's going to expand it into this. Okay, you can see it. So our line is for file name in dollar at. So when the shell sees dollar at, it's going to expand it to all the command line arguments. So effectively, the line which the shell is going to execute looks like this. For file name in, okay, and the names, the whole thing. So root.txt. This is the actual line that the shell is going to see. So once the shell is done with expansion, this is what's actually going to expand to. This is what it looks like. So if you type for file name in, so for name in list, this is our list, fruits, veg, except extras, but yes. So this is the list. So,
will this work if we put like shell script and star?
Shell script and star, yes, it will work. Because, I'll tell you that in the end of this shell script.
This is
SSD, right? Yes, everything. Oh, yeah, that's a typo. So it's supposed to be small d. So this is our script. So this is our script using the. So what does this do? What does this work? So what it does is, now this is expanded to that. Okay? This is expanded to that. So what it does is, the first time this the shell is looping through this construct, it's going to assign the first word over here to this variable, file name. So file name variable is going to contain the word fruits.txt. Okay. So here we inside our script we're using dollar file name. So like I said earlier, the shell sees dollar in a variable name, it's going to expand it with a value. So in the first loop, dollar file name is going to expand to fruits.txt. So now it's gonna sort fruits.txt and print the output. Now done. Now when you hit done, you're gonna go for the second loop. Now in the second iteration of the loop, file name variable is assigned the value veg.txt, and that expands over here. You're gonna get the output of veg.txt with duplicates removed. Same thing for the third one, it's gonna be extras. And when the list ends, the loop terminates. So the loop will terminate, iterate three times, and now your list is done, it's going to stop. So that's the termination condition, the number of items in your list. Okay, so do you have any questions? So I'm just going to start with glob expressions. Okay, maybe I'll just tell this and So suppose we want to modify the script. Yeah.
Can it directly output to a variable output name, like kind of you're giving dollar file name, right? And you are giving different input file names. And I want to direct it to.
Yes. Yeah, of course, you can do that. So you can do something like this. You can do something like this. Command. Yeah, I was maybe supposed to show that. Let's put the other one here. Okay. So it's simple. You can understand it because $1 is going to expand, right? So after it expands, it's just going to be command greater redirect and some filing. So it's going to work as expected.
Well, will it give me an extension of what I did add dot output like so that I can understand it?
Yes, so $1 is whatever you pass on the command line argument.
$1 first has fruits.txt, right?
Right. So you'll get a file name fruits.txt. If you passed something like fruits.dat, you're going to get a file with that name, fruits.dat.
The output will be just... Really
yeah, it'll be just exactly that word.
But can't I store it in a different file while giving a different...
Sorry?
Append another extension.
You want to add another extension?
Yeah, so that I can have both my input and output later.
No. See, you can put $2 over here. Okay, so...
So let me... Ershaad,
yeah.
So she wants... So you have operated the unique operator and you have an output. She wants to call that output as fruits_unique.txt.
Okay.
Is that possible? How to do that?
Yes, it is. It is possible. Now, the syntax is a little... You want an output name which is based on the input name, right?
If possible.
Right? Yeah, it's possible. So, suppose you did sort $1, okay, unique, and you want to go to some... You can give it something like this, okay, $1 dot out or something, okay. Now, these are curly braces. Now, why do you put a curly brace here? Now, I told you that the shell, whenever it sees a dollar sign, it interprets whatever it sees as a variable name. So the shell is going to see $. If you didn't have these braces, the shell is going to think this entire thing is a variable name. And it's going to say that it's going to expand to what? It's going to expand to empty because this variable not assigned to anything. So you need to tell the shell where the variable name starts and ends. So you just put a like this, okay, curly braces. So now the shell knows that this is the variable and it's going to append this extension to that variable. Okay. So curly braces. That's what you mean.
Can we also pass it to some other variable which can be used later in the same script? Same variable. Some other variable other than the...
No, you can't store the output in a variable. You have to use... at the end of this shell scripting class, we're teaching you command substitution. So command substitution allows you to capture the output of a command into a variable. So if you put greater than some variable name, it won't work. It will say that the file does not exist. Right? So how to capture to a variable, I'll show you in command substitution. I think maybe we'll stop because this is like one set of stuff. Any other questions?
Conditional operator
looks
like this. Can you put a pipeline command
which are
there?
Yes. Yeah. You can do that, yeah, exactly. So that's also a good question. So you can do something like this. You can do if, okay? Do something like this. So when does this evaluate to true? So this command is going to be, this entire pipeline is going to be executed. It's going to read a file, it's going to pipe the output to sort, unique, remote duplicates, and it's going to check if this word is contained. Now this condition evaluates to true if the last command evaluates to true. So if grep returns a zero, this whole thing is successful. So it all depends on the last command in the pipeline. But you can use a pipeline.
Sorry?
File name, variable name,
positive 3 to 5.
For file name.
In this script.
This one?
Yeah. So, how does it know what is file name?
File name, yeah, this is a. So, whatever name you use here, that's the name you have to use inside. So, So if I gave F name here, I would use that.
He's asking, so how did file name get the value fruits dot text? Because he's invoking the command.
Is that
what? At the command prompt, you give file name.
Right, yeah.
So how do you execute this shell? Can you give an example of the execution of this shell? Dot slash unique fruits dot set.
Okay, you want to see how this script will be executed?
Basically,
he's
trying to get that file name word.
So he's going to
about the keyword file name, the file name word. Okay, can you ask the question again? You're asking about this?
Yeah.
This file name, it's anything. You can choose any variable name you like.
The variable is defined here.
Yes, the variable is defined here. So whatever name you choose here, you have to use that same name inside. So suppose you had another loop with a file. Suppose this loop was inside a bigger loop, and that loop was using file name. So here you would have to use something different. So you give file name one, and then you use file name one, you don't have file name. Any valid shell variable. So there are some rules that use underscore character.
Sir, if you do grep in a command prompt,